What do you think about Waiheke?
I've literally only been to the port and the winery, but I rate any place that they grow alcohol on.
Whether you're looking for a boozy playground, pristine beaches, or a vibrant community, Waiheke Island seems to have it all.
Get off him!
But what's really going on beneath the surface?
57 years old, all these people with their big flash houses, and I'm busting my guts harder than any of them. I ain't got nothing.
There's a historical significance to this land. And we'll lose that with having this marina here. For not just Māori, but for all New Zealanders.
Our cultural heritage does not belong to the moneyed few that fly in and know nothing about us. They will never be welcome. Never.
We're Josh and Mearle, and we're on a mission to find out what's really going on underneath Waiheke Island.
For those keen to leave the big smoke behind and taste the high life, Waiheke is only a 40-minute ferry ride away. And we're heading there now.
It's hard, it's gonna work.
We'll get there.
Get in there. I'm surprised we even made it, to be honest. This boat is a lot smaller than you told me it was. I'm not articulate
like you. Over the years, Mearle and I have been on some crazy adventures together.
We bloody love our beautiful little country, and Waiheke is definitely one of Aotearoa's finest destinations. Yeah.
Sorry.
This place is known as the Island of Wine.
We made it, sir.
So what better to check out first than one of the many vineyards and sink some piss, probably.
In the late 70s, the first vines were planted, which kick-started this now booming industry and put Waiheke on the map.
I don't think I've ever seen you in a shirt.
Right.
We've put on our number ones, and we're meeting with the head winemaker at one of the fanciest vineyards on the island.
G'day, Ross.
Josh.
Mearle. Hey, how you going?
I'm good, boys. How are you guys going?
Good. Very well. Why are there so many vineyards here? Like, what's special about Waiheke?
We're on an island. And the oceans act as like a temperature regulator that allows us to ripen certain varieties that you couldn't in other places in New Zealand.
It's pretty technical, eh?
Yeah,
man. I thought we were just meeting up with an alcoholic dude.
Yeah. Well, you are.
How important do you reckon the wine industry is to the local economy?
We employ a huge amount of people, and it's not just here at Cable Bay, it's all the wine industry on Waiheke that does that. So. Yeah, the island wouldn't be the same without it.
I've got an important question. How many bottles of wine have you had so far this morning?
What time is it now? 10? I'll probably have 3 today.
Yeah.
But
bottles?
But, yeah, go for it. Go for it. Nah, but no, none yet. None yet. As of yet, yeah.
All this chat about wine has made us thirsty, so we've decided we're going to do some wine tasting.
A couple of small glasses. We won't get carried away. Not on camera anyway.
Today we're going to start with a very seductive grape variety, Viognier.
Ooh. What is it again?
Viognier. Do you know how to pronounce it?
Viognier.
Pretty much.
You like cask wine?
Ah, cask wine. I use it for cooking. That's quite good for cooking. What do you think of this wine?
Mmm, yum. It's a sweeter flavour, no?
No.
It tastes sweet as.
Yeah.
Sweet as, yeah. That's good.
We're clearly not the target demographic, but the atmosphere is pumping, so we're heading out to mix and mingle with some real wine connoisseurs.
Cheers. What's your name?
I'm Connor.
I'm Aiden.
Aiden, first.
What have you been up to today? Bit of drinking?
That's about it, really.
What's your guys' relationship?
Met him in primary school. Then he started saying I was bullying him, but I never did.
I can imagine you bullying him.
I promise you, I 100% never bullied him.
You're the archetype of a bully.
I get it. I'm a big guy. I'm a little bit intimidating, but I definitely did not. I did not bully him.
What do you think about Waiheke?
I've literally only been to the port and the winery, but I rate it. I rate any place that they grow alcohol on.
These lads that we've met, they're not exactly what the type of crowd that I would expect at this high-class establishment. Sir. Do you think you'll see any other parts of Waiheke or just where the parts where they grow up?
Nah.
Definitely not today. Mm. Do a few more party favours and I'm probably going to end up at home about 10 o'clock, go to sleep. Look at this. You can't really complain if you're here.
Nah.
You know awesome. What I mean?
There's no denying this is a beautiful place and it's a bloody good time. But what do the locals think about what this island has become?
I'm completely over Waiheke.
Oh, Waiheke, I like that.
It's becoming very gentrified and you can win lotto and still not have enough money to buy a place.
I can look at that house up there and I can say, you f***ing rich c***. I've worked harder than any of you f***ing. And you've got a house up there, you f***ing will go and do a big poo on your f***ing doorstep. But I'm not like that.
After checking out Waiheke's wine scene for ourselves, it's easy to see why the vineyards attract nearly a million visitors each year.
Look at this. Can't really complain if you're here.
But we want to meet some real locals.
You, sir.
So we're off to find some true blue Waihekeans at one of the island's most pumping local hotspots.
Hello.
We're at the Waiheke Bowls Club, and the vibe here is a little different to what we've experienced so far.
They seem a little older.
No.
G'day.
Good day.
Hello.
Welcome to Waiheke.
Waiheke.
Yeah, Waiheke. We're so far out, we're on the way back again.
You can't come to a bowling green and not roll a bowl. So we're getting taught how to do it by Malcolm, who's been doing it for probably a good 100 years or so. How long have you been on Waiheke for?
Well, I started in 52.
Yeah. Whoa!
Wow.
What's Waiheke appeal to me? Well, it's just far enough away to be different. It's far enough away from Auckland and we've got everything here that we want.
Do you go to the vineyards?
No. A fair amount of wheat bix.
Fair amount of wheat bix.
All right. About 2.5. We're not over keen about Waiheke becoming too overcrowded.
How's that, Malcolm?
He's got a nice release. Bit selfish, but we don't want too many people down here.
Oh, that's too much. I think I gave that about 4 wheat bix.
He's gone too deep.
Wow.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Well, well done.
You did well, sir.
So, well, you too.
You come back next time and we'll show you something else.
We'll let you go grab those. Thank you. No. Just kidding. We'll go get the balls.
It's nice hanging out with some actual locals. It seems like there's a lot of history here and people have been coming for a long time. And it turns out there's something else happening here tonight.
So good evening everyone, welcome to the bowling club. I'll start with the first song. For once in my life, I have someone who needs me.
Tonight is Waiata Wednesday,
Yep, karaoke night here at the club.
It's a very warm atmosphere. Everyone seems very friendly.
We're catching up with a guy named Naroa who actually started the Waiata Wednesdays here on the island.
How you going?
I'm going good. How are you two doing?
Very good. Seems like a pretty cool vibe in there.
That's lovely. It's totally inclusive. That's the main thing. The better you sing, fantastic. If you're not so good, whoever's after you will sound amazing.
What's the crowd like that comes in here?
Oh, it's a fruit salad kind of crowd.
What? Fruit salad?
Fruit salad or mixed nuts, more like it.
How important do you reckon a place like this is for locals?
I think the nice thing about it is we know each other, you know, and you can, like, be happy to talk, smile, make a mistake and stuff. So I think it's very important. The only thing is I'm not sure how long it's going to last. There's a lot of money coming to the island, and I'm not sure if people are interested in taking up the mantle. But there's progress, you know, it's beyond us. What can we do?
Well, while it's still here, people are definitely making the most of it, including us. I want to break free.
I feel lucky that we've been able to come.
Yeah, it feels like a family. One big tone-deaf family.
From the luxurious to the cheap and cheerful, this island has shown two very different sides. Is it inevitable that outdated places here fade away to make room for the flash and fancy?
It's time to dig a little deeper.
Waiheke was first occupied by Māori. Before Europeans settled here, deforested and farmed the land.
It then morphed into an alternative artist and poet community until evolving into the wine and tourist industry that exists today.
But it seems one important part of Waiheke's history has remained hidden in plain sight. Until now.
We're meeting with Tim Moon, a successful businessman who has dedicated himself to restoring an underground military fortress right here on Waiheke.
Kia ora.
Hello.
Welcome to Stony Batter.
How's it going?
I'm Tim.
Mearle.
Josh. Tim,
Josh,
nice to meet you.
Going to go on an adventure?
Yeah,
sweet. Okay.
Follow me.
Have you ever just walked around here in the nude for fun?
No.
Can we?
I don't want to be in the same room. Especially with that mullet.
At last, war really comes to New Zealand. From the north across these peaceful waters comes a shadow. Japan strikes without warning, west, east, and south. Parliament assembles to discuss new grave dangers to our security.
Well, Stony Batter was established in 1942 under secret orders of the government to protect Auckland from foreign invasion from the sea. It comprises three gun turrets, 1.5 kilometres of underground passages, all tunnelled by hand, 13 chambers of enormous sizes, larger than houses.
Whoa. Whoa, this is cool.
Epic.
At the end of the war, it really just fell abandoned. So I came along, found a place that was just locked up, neglected. So I negotiated a lease off the government to run this as a heritage tourism business.
Oh, yes, this is the gun.
Yeah, boys, this is the gun turret. Look at it. Absolutely massive piece of engineering.
Where's the gun?
Well, it was decommissioned in the 1950s.
The gun isn't there.
Yeah,
anti-climax?
Yeah, I thought we were going to get to shoot it.
Okay, boys, now we're going to head down to the underworld. We're going to descend 42 metres below the surface.
Whoa.
Underworld. Scary.
So what's happening here is we're passing under the forest and we're going under a stream.
Wow.
The deeper we go, the more interesting it becomes. We realise that this isn't just a one-off tunnel. This is a friggin' huge fortress. How would they have dug this bit in?
Mate, I look at this and I wonder in many situations how on earth they constructed it. This is definitely an engineering and architectural marvel.
Do you think that you and I could build a structure similar to this?
I'd just surrender. Yeah. Like, what's the point?
This is the command bunker. All the communications for coming into here. So any potential enemy has been tracked by radar.
So did anyone come in?
Yep. A fleet of Japanese flew into Auckland and they photographed all of downtown Auckland. They were able to write their battle plans and get ready for an invasion.
Wow.
Incredible. That's
fascinating. So we were pretty close to being attacked.
Mate, seriously, we were probably about 6 months away from being invaded.
It's crazy that something so important to New Zealand's history could be hidden deep underground all this time.
This is where the tours separate.
But it's not over yet, and Tim has a few surprises up his sleeve.
We're deep underground visiting Stony Batter, where a local businessman, Tim, is restoring one of New Zealand's largest military fortresses.
Wow!
Voila!
But not every room has been returned to its original state.
Well, this is a meditation space. This is available for anyone in the Waiheke community to come down, and it's complimentary. They don't have to pay for it. Any of the work we undertake here, we do not affect the heritage fabric in any way whatsoever.
Oh, whoa. Oh my goodness.
Concert chamber is set up primarily for music performances or theatre productions. Either of you guys play?
We dabble.
Come on over to the piano.
Thank you very much.
What do you think, Tim?
I don't think you'll sell many tickets.
There's the light. I don't think that many people would come over to Waiheke and expect there to be such an attraction as this. Like, it's quite bizarre, isn't it?
How's this?
Whoa.
Isn't this an amazing place?
It is superb.
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
And when we really think, this is what it was protecting, that horizon line.
What is it that draws you to this place?
What it was really about was just having such a piece of history that nobody was respecting, nobody was understanding.
Have you ever tried to tie in with the vineyards and that type of thing in a tourism way?
Yeah, well, that's a little bit political because I'm completely over Waiheke.
Waiheke, I like that.
The island has just gone through many, many different cultural changes. I look at that and think that people coming here need something else on offer. It's becoming very gentrified, and I'm worried that we will lose some of the important natural amenity, which is this place's real asset.
But you'll probably move downstairs?
I'll be dead by then.
Will you be buried in the tunnels?
No, I don't think so.
Fantastic. Thanks for showing us around.
You're welcome. All the best, boys.
Alrighty.
That way.
Catch ya.
Ciao.
It's inspiring to see Tim bringing this wounded wonder of the past back to life. But it sounds like not everyone shares his vision of preserving Waiheke's heritage.
we're heading to the famous Waiheke markets to meet with a local activist and learn about the threats this island is facing. Hello.
Oh, kia ora.
How are you?
Fine.
Hello, Susie.
Kia ora, hola.
This is a nice spot.
Yeah, right in the middle.
Apparently you're a bit of a legend here on Waiheke Island.
I don't know who told you that. I'm actually quite a private person, but I guess my background, I'm one of the co-founders of Greenpeace International. My name is Susie Newborn. I'm very humbled and somewhat privileged to have been the person who gave the boat her name, the Rainbow Warrior.
Rainbow Warrior was a very important part of Greenpeace and activists' history.
I thought it was a flamboyant gay superhero.
What do we need to know about what's happening here?
You may have heard of a campaign called Save Kennedy Point. They're trying to build a marina from one end of the bay to the other, the size of 8 Eden parks. It's like putting a McDonald's next to Stonehenge. It is.
Yeah.
Got the visual?
Yep.
It would irrevocably change our island. Our cultural heritage does not belong to the moneyed few that fly in and then get on a super yacht for 2 weeks and come here and know nothing about us.
Unfortunately, this marina conflict continues to escalate and is now reaching boiling point.
It's a battle between two main sides, developers wanting to build a new marina at the island's Kennedy Point, and those groups who say the development should never have been given the green light. It's resulted in protest occupation of the land, arrests, and growing concern for the wildlife caught up in the middle.
We know that Te Kapu Moana Hauraki Gulf is on the brink of collapse. What are we going to do? What are we going to do right now to arrest this development and to make sure that our ecosystem has a moment to breathe and to restore?
Despite public outcry, the marina is still charging ahead. What do you think the outcome's going to be?
They will never be welcome. Never.
Wow.
Yeah.
Sounds like we have to check out Putiki, doesn't it?
Yeah. But scared now.
Haramai manuhiri, haramai. Haramai e te whare o, whare o, horo whenua.
We're at Putiki Bay, visiting a local iwi who have set up camp on the beach in protest of the controversial marina development. The iwi's objections have set the development back months.
My name's Toa, I'm the mandated rep for Ngāti Pāua. It's nice to see you guys today. Welcome, let's have a chat.
Thank you.
Nau mai, haramai.
Considering how contentious this issue is of the marina, the iwi are very warm and welcoming. Thanks so much for having us.
Can you explain a bit about what you're doing here?
We're against the construction. We've just felt compelled to be here to be able to stand on behalf of our iwi and hapu.
Who do you think ultimately would benefit from this development out here?
Oh, it has to be the rich, doesn't it? It has to be.
What's so annoying about the whole thing here is that there's no benefit to the island. There's no benefit to the community. It only benefits that privileged few. Our Ngāti Pāua Trust Board are fighting a fight in the Environment Court. You know, while they're doing it the legal way, we're here to just occupy the land. Yeah, so this is where all the whānau come.
It may be far from five-star living, but the occupiers have set up whatever they can to get by. What's it like living here?
Pretty awkward. I mean, there's no running water here. We don't have electricity. To be able to survive over the period that we've been here, there were some very challenging cold nights. But again, if that's the little sacrifice I have to pay it's worth it. It's totally worth it.
The fact that they've been roughing it here for a year without any of these sort of bare necessities shows just how passionate they really are.
Well, what's your favourite things about living in this bay?
The wildlife. You know, the orca pods come through here.
Wow.
The dolphins. I mean, we've got schools of kingfish. The clarity is beautiful. It's also where a lot of families have come for generations and had memories built here. I want this bay to be free for not my grandchildren, my grandchildren's grandchildren. There's a historical significance, and we'll lose that with having this marina here. Not just our whānau, not just Māori, but for all New Zealanders.
Aramai.
With the future of the bay in serious doubt, we want to make the most of it while we still can.
It's a crazy experience taking in this beautiful scenery, but then there's just this constant sound of the marina being developed. This has been a bittersweet experience.
While their spirit and determination is inspiring, it does feel like they're fighting a losing battle.
One thing that's becoming clear on this island is the division of wealth. With obscene house prices and one of the highest rates of homelessness in New Zealand, the more time we spend here, the more complex this place seems. We're meeting with a long-time local who's struggled to keep up with modern-day Waiheke.
A seasoned labourer, an aspiring musician, and a renowned local fisherman. Nearly everybody we've met has had a story about this guy.
G'day.
G'day, hey, Roger.
How you going?
Well, you want to go fishing, do you? My name is Roger. Some people call me Jolly Roger. Pull her out there, mate. Look at that. That's it.
I've been coming here since I was 3 years of age, so probably 55 years. Jump in the front, mate. Just nicely, easy, easy, easy. Why do people know me? Because I've been around a long time. Done a lot of hard yards. I don't know about ragging around the edges, but can't be too much of a goody-goody, can you?
If you're going to take a slash, just make sure you're not facing up there because you have little kids and families watching your telescopes. So when you shake your doodle, don't give it any more than two shakes or else I think you're playing with your todger. And only Roger's allowed to play with his todger.
Instantly, it's pretty clear that he's a very unique guy with a wicked sense of humour.
So you're a musician as well, as a fisherman?
I'm an all-rounder, mate, actually.
What was the name of your song?
It's called Well-Winked Wiener.
Well-Winked Wiener?
Yeah. It's all about the make a love process, mate. We're not here to talk about that. We're going fishing.
Where do you cook your fish?
There's barbecue down there, but I just give it away to people, mate.
All we've got to do is get three good snapper and you guys got fish for dinner.
So how has Waiheke changed over the last 55 years?
Heaps. 55 years ago, there was only 10, 15, 20 houses here. Now you've got 1,000 just around this area. All these people, they're big four-wheel drives and big V8s. But if you're old and you're ugly and you're broke and you stink, nobody wants to know you. Like, who is this guy? Who is this guy? I keep hearing about this guy. Who is he? Here he is. Oh, he's ugly. Has he got any money? No. I'm dumb off.
Considering his current living situation, it's easy to see why wealth is such a touchy subject.
Yeah, I've been living in a car for about 4 years now.
What is it like living in your car for 4 years?
Well, what do you think it's like, mate, honestly? I'm not being rude to you, but what do you think it's like? Wouldn't be very nice, would it?
You're living in your car, but you're surrounded by multi-million dollar batches. How does that make you feel?
I can look at that house up there and I can say, you f***ing rich c***. I've worked harder than any of you f***. And you've got a house up there, you f***. I'll go and do a big poo on your f***ing doorstep. But I'm not like that. I know how hard I've tried for 25 odd years, working hard on the island, smashing rock. I've got a guts full of this, mate. Most of these foundations around these houses have been dug by me.
Wow.
I'm pretty rooted now, though, my arms. I'm just tired of it now. I'm worn out. I'll tell you, I've never been so down and out and depressed in my life, mate. I've thought about suicide many a time. Bugger it, had enough. Vanish, just to vanish. I thought about it with the amount of pains and wounds, and then I thought, I might as well stick it out to the bitter end, otherwise I'm a coward. You know what I mean? I quite like waking up and having a cup of coffee and all the rest of it, but I'd rather wake up in my own house and, you know, get my hands on the bosoms.
Would it be fair to say that this has been the most eye-opening experience that we've had on Waiheke so far?
Yeah, I haven't felt more conflicted than this. Like, one second I'm pissing myself laughing, and the next I'm feeling hopeless for the whole situation. It's quite sad, to be honest.
You on?
Yep.
Yeah!
Woo!
Yeah.
Oh!
See?
That's
persistence.
Huge!
Okay, we're in, mate. Ooh. Just as we talk, look at that, eh? No gloves around here, mate. No gloves.
Oh, got off! Oh, it's back on again! It doesn't take long. Soon we've got a boat full of snapper. Yeah, boy, look at that. We're bloody happy, boys.
See, we were about to leave here, weren't we? I said, well, we'll have one more go, shall we? Don't give up, mate. Until you're dead, you've got no choice then.
I love Roger's optimism, but it is kind of sad to see someone who's lived on this island for so long and given so much to this community have nothing.
I don't really know who I'm meant to be. Even if I did, you'd be out of reach.
It's clear that Waiheke's changed a lot since Roger's been here. I don't know if that's for the better or for the worse, but if he's living in his car, can't be that great, can it?
It seems this island is in much more trouble than we thought. And a wild event is about to make things a whole lot worse. Overnight, a storm has rolled in, and we've woken to the news that a yacht has sadly washed up onto the rocks.
You want to take a couple of floats?
Yep.
Or whatever you can manage.
Locals are rallying together to help, so we're heading down to lend a hand.
Got to be suited and booted.
Suited and booted.
Or you end up rooted, you know.
Have you ever worked on a shipwreck before? Your life is a shipwreck.
No, a train wreck.
Oh, a train wreck.
Is it?
I don't know. It's definitely wrecked in a lot of ways.
Oh my god.
Oh wow.
Fuck, that's sad.
Oh, This is bloody treacherous. Jesus.
The ladder as well?
Whew. After a gnarly walk down, we're greeted by the devastated yacht owners.
Hey, Matt.
I'm Ari, and this is Ben. And we're here to salvage the carnage of our beautiful vessel.
What happened?
She dragged anchor. She dragged all the way from the other side of the bay, hit the rocks with her rudder. There's nothing we can do. She's been squeezed like a lemon on a grater. For the last 8 years, this was our home. And here she finds her grave. That's it.
Today we're offloading a lot of stuff. Getting off valuables, getting off junk, getting off stuff that we can reuse or sell off or give away, because it's all becoming carnage really quickly.
How has the community response been?
It's been heartwarming. We're surrounded by beautiful fauna. To me, it was way more than I expected. People talk a lot, you know. These people are doing. I see young people. I see old salts. There's Iwi on board, there's Pakia on board, all kinds of nationalities on board. So heartwarming to me. And I think that's a hope for the future.
I'm really sorry that you're having to go through this, but it's nice to see you taking some positives.
Thank you, mate.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thanks, Matt.
It's a tricky place to have a hug, isn't it? On the rocks, yeah.
Well, it's time to get stuck in and do our part.
How can we help? All in all, this has been a really crazy experience, and although it's devastating, I'm actually kind of grateful that I've been allowed to help out in a very small way.
I don't think you did really help, but the rest of that statement was lovely.
Our time on Waiheke has come to an end.
I don't know if the people here will remember us, but I feel like we'll remember them.
We will, because we've recorded them and we can watch the footage back.
Exactly.
This island is certainly changing. And while progress is inevitable, unfortunately, it seems this always comes at a cost.
Although to us it's been pretty clear there's a lot of contrasting opinions and conflict between people here, I think the one thing they do have in common is that they all love Waiheke.
Where to next, man?
Wherever the sun takes us. Or the dinghy before it breaks.
We're not going to make it very far, are we?
Are you good at guitar?
I just stress the guitar, man. Ning, ning, ning. And I bring around the left hands. I just love the power of the electric guitar.
Do you know like chords and stuff now?
No, I don't do any chords, mate. Just I'll do a little bit.